James Harrington's The Commonwealth of Oceana. The English Revolution of 1640 to 1660 was a time of upheaval and disruption. It brought chaos to people's lives, but also sparked innovative ideas on politics and government. One of the most experimental works to emerge from this period was James Harrington's The Commonwealth of Oceana. This complex and multi-layered book aimed to heal and settle the divisions created by civil war by offering a workable model of republican or Commonwealth government for England, Scotland and Ireland. Harrington's background prior to the 1650s offered little sense of the path he would take. Born into a gentry family in 1611, he lived a conventional and rather obscure life until war broke out. Moreover, his family had kinship connections to the Stuarts. James Harrington followed older family members into royal service, albeit in unusual circumstances. He acted as an agent for Charles I's nephew, Charles Louis, in England during the 1640s, and after 1646 was employed by Parliament as a personal servant to the captive king. Yet Harrington was also a revolutionary writer. Almost all his works were produced during the Revolution, the majority between 1656 and 1660, under Oliver Cromwell's protectorate. And they responded directly to the events taking place. Moreover, both the ideas he advocated and the means by which he conveyed them were innovative. He was lauded both in his own time and subsequently as the author of the influential theory that political power is grounded in economic power. By studying past commonwealths, including those of Athens, Sparta, Rome, Israel and Venice, he crafted a new form of government based on ancient political theory, but suited to the circumstances of the modern world. Though often described as a utopia, his best-known book, The Commonwealth of Oceana, defies categorisation. It combines political theory, historical narrative, and model constitution, as well as fictional elements, deploying narrative, descriptive passages, dialogue, and even variation in typeface to engage with and convince readers. As a political theorist, Harrington was adamant that government would only be successful if attention was paid to both the foundations and the superstructure of the system. His theory about the economic basis of political power was central to this. Adapting the common argument that political power is dependent on force, Harrington pointed out that to command an army, it is necessary to feed it. And so the wielding of political power is necessarily dependent on the possession of land. On this basis, Harrington devised his own typology of government. Where one man owned all the land, as for example in Turkey at the time, the appropriate form of government would be absolute monarchy. Where the ownership of land was shared among a narrow elite comprising the monarch and rich nobles, as has been the case for centuries in England, mixed monarchy was the best form. But where land was divided among a large swathe of the population, Commonwealth government would be most appropriate. The historical analysis that Harrington offered in Oceana was designed to show that since the time of Henry VII, the ownership of land in England had shifted from a narrow elite to a broader section of the population. Consequently, by the 17th century, England was ripe for Commonwealth government. The Civil War was then, on his account, an inevitable attempt to bring the political structure into line with the economic reality. While the form of government had to fit the circumstances, if stability and durability were to be secured, Harrington also argued that some types of government were objectively better than others. On his analysis, Commonwealth government was not just the best form for England at the time, but also had the potential to be the best form of government available. To achieve this, however, it needed to include certain key elements. For the most part, these elements were designed to either prevent or diminish the effects of corruption at various levels. Like his contemporary Thomas Hobbes, Harrington adopted a rather pessimistic view of human nature. He believed that, left to their own devices, human beings will tend to act in their own interests rather than putting the common good first, and that even a good person who held power for too long would become corrupt. This made the idea of virtuous rule that was often deemed central to republican government at the time look impossible. Harrington's argument was that by careful crafting of the constitution and clever use of institutions, it would be possible to ensure that it was in the self-interest of political actors to act in the public good. A key example of this was Harrington's absolute and unwavering insistence on the need for a bicameral, two-chamber legislature. The upper house, in Harrington's model an elected body, but with members chosen from among the wealthier members of society, would debate ideas before putting forward legislative proposals to the lower house, which was elected from and by all citizens, and which would vote silently to accept or reject the Senate's proposal. Harrington believed that by this means the state would get the benefits of the Senate's deliberations, but at the same time, members of the Senate could not just put forward proposals in their own interests, or if they did, they would be rejected by the lower house. Harrington illustrated how this worked by reference to his famous analogy of two girls dividing a cake between them. One girl cuts the cake, but it is for the other to have first choice of which piece she wants. On this basis, the first girl will be determined to divide the cake as evenly as possible. Harrington also worried that people could become corrupt if they held power for too long. To obviate this problem, he proposed a system of rotation of office, whereby members of both the Senate and lower house of the legislature, as well as members of local assemblies and almost all office holders within the state, would only be in place for a limited period of time. In most cases, they would hold their position for 3 years and would then be required to spend 3 years out of office before being eligible for re-election. This also had the advantage of ensuring that they would have to live under the laws that they had made. Finally, Harrington recognised that corruption could creep in at the point of electing representatives. To counter this problem, he advocated a secret ballot based on Venetian practice. Ballots were not secret in England at the time. Indeed, they continued to be public into the 19th century, when the Chartists included voting by secret ballot as one of their 6 demands for parliamentary reform. Harrington's model of government was complex. He claimed that it was one in which the wisdom of the nation propose and the interest of the nation resolve. He also deliberately used the then unfashionable term democracy to describe it. There were some grounds for this. In terms of the extent of his franchise and the lack of a property qualification for voters at the lowest level, Harrington's model was far more democratic than was typical of the time. Moreover, in advocating a fully elected second chamber and regular rotation of office, it could be said that his model was more democratic than most systems that are in existence today. Indeed, despite the fact that he was writing over 350 years ago, there are still things that we might learn from Harrington's Oceana.